Good morning, my name's Holly Saunders and I'm going to be talking to you today about oil pastels. Oil pastels have got a bit of a bad reputation in the art world as being a rather secondary art medium, and I find them very, very good and I've worked with them for many, many years. I think we tend to think of them as the oil pastel we had at school, which is a little bit disappointing, quite hard to use, and hopefully today I can show you different ways of using oil pastel. And how you can get detail, how you can blend them, how you can scrape through, and if you wish, how you can use them with white spirit. But they are very versatile and very easy to use medium, and I'd like to prove everybody wrong by saying they are a fantastic thing to use. They fall into two main categories. The oil pastel we all had at school, which is rather cheap and quite difficult to use, and that's what's put us all off, and the artist quality oil pastel, primarily the Snellier oil pastel. Now, the Snellier oil pastel was the one that Picasso asked Snellier to make for him, and that's where we get oil pastel from. So it was an invention invented by Picasso, if you like, and it's basically an oil stick. It's oil based, but it also has wax in there and pigment. And with the student ones, there's less pigment and more wax. That's what makes them quite tricky to use. And the artist one, they are very, very strong colours, lots and lots of strong pigment and a bigger range of fantastic colours. And why I love them so much is their immediacy. So you can pick a stick up and draw straight away. So if you're outside, for example, you can just pick up a few sticks and draw straight onto a canvas or a piece of paper and off you go. You don't have to squeeze out any tubes. And as an oil painter, when I wanted to work outside, I found the oil pastel very easy and very immediate. Today we're going to be working from a photograph, however, and hopefully I'll be able to show you all the different techniques, scraping through, blending, blending with white spirit and with a medium, and transferring. And transferring is quite an original way to use oil pastel. I have actually blown up that photograph to a black and white A4 copy, and on the back of that I have put white oil pastel. And to get that image onto a canvas, I've put the black and white photocopy on top of the canvas. I've pressed, in this case with a red pencil so I can see where I've been, pressed onto it, and it leaves a lovely white line in oil pastel on the canvas. The preparation of the canvas has just been acrylic gesso mixed with a little bit of acrylic grey colour to give this mid-tone background. And there you can see that I've got this image very easily onto the canvas. I think it's important when we're working from photographs to remember they are purely a starting point, and to use our memory and our feelings about the place. This is an area of Gloucestershire I know very, very well, so I'm going to be interpreting the colours I remember it. We're going to start with the sky, which in the photograph is white, but I remember this afternoon being particularly sunny with a lovely blue sky. Okay, we're going to start with the sky. We're just going to use a couple of oil pastels, a white and a blue. I'm going to put some white there. And you can see how well these oil pastels blend together. In a mixture of blues and white. They are very creamy. These are Snellier oil pastels, which I definitely think are the best. Though the student ones have their place as well. We can follow the lines, go slightly over the lines if you wish, because the trees are going to go over the edge, and therefore you'll get that feeling of the sky being behind the trees. And I'm just going to add a little bit of dry brushing to blend them even further. So that's a hog hair brush and a little bit of white spirit. I'll get rid of any marks you don't like. It's important to use a hog hair brush, as a soft hair brush would be too soft. It wouldn't be strong enough to blend oil pastel, because oil pastel is quite heavy and sticky. I'm going to blend that all down. This technique is a little bit like painting. Of course, it's not something you have to do every time you use oil pastel, but it's a useful tip. You certainly don't want to have too much white spirit on the brush. So we've done the sky, and now we're going to move on to the distant tree line. And remember, when you're working from photographs, you can adapt the colour. When things are in the distance, we add a little bit more blue. And so I'm going to be putting quite a lot of blues into these trees to push them away. And similarly, when we come down to the foreground, we want to add some warmth down here to pull this cottage forward. But as I say, we're going to start up here. And so if you pick up a variety of greens and blues, and you can blend them all together. There's quite a lot of shadow at the bottom of the trees. You can look at the photograph for reference, obviously. That's what it's there for, but it's really just a reference tool. Put some nice dark blues in there. Nice rich Prussian blue. And see how beautifully these pastels mix together, blend together, blending all the greens and the blues. Push up into the sky, overlap the sky, so you feel that the trees are sitting in front of the skyline. One of the main complaints with oil pastel is that you cannot get any detail with it. And I'm going to show you one of the ways of getting detail with oil pastels, to scrape through. So if you layer it up, one colour on top of the other, you can scrape through to the bottom layer using a sharp object, a knife or a nail. You can see you can come right through to the grey colour underneath and reveal some of the blue as well. And this is particularly good if you're doing textures on animal fur or whiskers or that sort of thing. You can get minute amounts of detail revealing the colours underneath, and literally hairline bits of detail. Equally, you can use this to get rid of mistakes if you've put down some pastel, but you really don't want it there. You can scrape it off. So we've filled in a little bit more on the canvas now, and I'm just going to show you how you can use stencils and masks to create even more detail. On the original photograph, we had telegraph poles, which I'm going to put in now using this mask. And I'm going to start off by using the dark brown pastel. These masks are designed for rubbing out, but they're wonderful because they give you these very precision detail holes and shapes and squares that you can push your pastel through to get little marks left on the canvas or the paper. That's quite dark and quite heavy. We want the effect of light hitting the pole, so we're going to put a little bit of white just to lighten it a bit. Using a little bit of white. That's better. The same with this one. There, you have your telegraph poles. And that's another way of creating detail with oil pastel. Another technique of getting detail onto the picture is by tracing through. And if you put oil pastel on tracing paper, I'll just scribble it on there. You can flip it over, press on the back, and you get a nice line left on your paper or your canvas. There, you've got your little bit of detail with your tree in front of the cottage there. Sometimes with your pastel pictures, it's nice to have a nice crisp line. And in this case, we've got the cottage, which is in front of the landscape, and it's got a nice solid roof. And we're going to do that by cutting a stencil into our original A4 black and white photocopy and lay it over the top. You could do this with just an ordinary piece of paper and run your pastel over the paper and the roof, or if you want the pastel to go, so that you can lift it off and get a nice crisp line there. Get these chimneys nice and crisp. Often, hopefully, a nice sharp line. As I mentioned in the beginning, there are student and artist quality oil pastels, and the student oil pastel has its place and can be very, very useful. It's harder than the artist quality pastel, but it can be broken and used on its side to cover large areas, which I'm going to do now. And the other huge advantage on student pastels, of course, is that they're very, very affordable. That's why you see them in schools. And they come in a terrific range of colours. One of the concerns people have is what to do with an oil pastel picture once it's finished. They can remain tacky for a little time and can collect dust if you put them on the wall straight away. However, if left for a period of time, they will harden. To speed that process up, you can spray fix them with an oil pastel fixative, which gives a nice sealant, and then the picture can be put on the wall almost straight away. Hopefully I've addressed all your fears about using oil pastel, and now you can go ahead and use them yourself. Thank you. Today we're in Lower Slaughter and I've chosen to paint this beautiful view in oil paints. However, I haven't brought my oil paints with me because I'm going to do some sketching and take a photograph and take all that information back with me to the studio and paint the final oil painting there. Before I start sketching, I'd like to talk a little bit about the materials I use. I use watercolour, a pan watercolour, and brushes and an HB or 2B pencil. I also bring with me a hardback watercolour sketchbook. The hardback is easier to use because you don't always want to bring an easel, and you can rest a hardback sketchbook on your knee. This paper is nice and heavy. It's a 140-pound weight of paper with a knot surface or cold press surface. The other thing I recommend is the pans can be very dark and sometimes you can forget what you've got in your palette. So I do this little swatch of colours here to reference as I'm painting. I also bring with me a watercolour barrel brush. Put water into the barrel of the brush, that way you don't have to keep on dipping into water. The wonderful thing about sketching is it makes you think about what's important about a composition, and you'd start off with very, very general shapes, gradually building those shapes up to create an interesting composition. The reason I chose this view is because you've got lovely contrast with the red of the brickwork and the green, but also you've got a fantastic focal point, which is obviously where the eye wants to rest, right in the centre there, where the water meets the mill. Now the rest, the trees around the outside, some of the foliage closer to us, you might not want to put in so much detail. When you see some nice light happening, as is the case now, just reference it very quickly. I've got a lovely bit of light happening on this roof here. So we're just going to make that a little bit darker up there. And of course you can make notes. There's a lovely bit of light happening on the water here. This is all light in here. This is light in here. And of course you can exaggerate darker bits. So this is very dark in here. That's lighter still. You're going to do that a little bit with watercolour in a minute as well. But when it happens, because it's going to... We've got a nice rolling clouds today, so it's not going to stay around for long, the light, so make sure you reference it as it happens. Got some wonderful light happening now on the water too, down here. Some fantastic reflections. So you're taking from the landscape what you need to make an interesting painting, an interesting thing for the viewer to look at, to view from the middle of the room. It's not an illustration, it's a painting to be viewed standing up from the middle of the room. If it was an illustration in the book, maybe you want to put every brick in, but in this case I don't. I want someone to be able to stand feet away from this, the final piece anyway. Once you're happy with that, you can indicate the edges of the canvas. It's not going to be a square and it's not going to be portrait format. So we've got the tops of the trees just almost touching the top of the canvas here, and the bottom of the canvas cuts across the water, and we'll have some fading out images of trees on the side here, same on this side to balance it, a little bit of water and some foliage down here. And now I'm ready to do some colour referencing. We're going to start by just adding cerulean blue pretty much all over the picture, and the reason for this is obviously we can change that blue into green by adding a little bit of yellow. Although the sky isn't cerulean over there, it is above my head, so we're not exactly cheating. It is a June day, so we're going to put that on. And again, it's this thing of working all over at once. So we do want the sky reflected in the water at the bottom here. These will be lovely green bushes. So we can put blue down there and a bit more blue over here and over here. With the tissue in my pocket, I'm just going to blot areas of that blue, bring in some cloud up here. And a little bit down on the water. I want to establish your lights and darks quite early on as well. So nice dark blue. Obviously blue pushes things away, so you've got a nice dark blue patch just behind the mill. Draw the eye in, and there's some lovely little bits of dark here. So you see, I need to work all over as much as I can. Now if I add yellow, we're going to get some lovely greens. Painting in this country, particularly in the summertime, not too bad in the autumn, there's an awful lot of green. So we're constantly looking for things to contrast the green with. I'm fortunate enough here to have some red brick, which is unusual for the Cotswolds, but it gives a wonderful contrast to all this green. And you want to keep on changing your greens, adding different blues to them to make them a little bit more interesting. So we're going to do some other washes now. Yellow ochre of the brickwork which is a very Cotswoldy colour. And again, this will be reflected in the water. I'm just going to add a bit of red, cadmium red, to make this wonderful brick red, the contrast to all the green. Down again, right through the pitcher, down into the water. Remember, as things go back, they get cooler. These distant trees can be very blue. Give a little bit more depth to the composition as well. And as they come forward, a bit more vibrant. So I just happen to have a lot of greens in my palette I can dip into. Apart from anything else, sketching outside is very enjoyable and you can get completely lost in the moment. And again, of course, you're thinking about the picture the whole time. I'm working quite intuitively as well. What looks nice, what feels right, what balances it. Yeah, keep painting all round, and the more you look, the more you will see. And when things change and you see an interesting colour, like there's some lovely purples going on down here, get those in. You want to hang on to any interesting colour that you can. I'm going to resist putting too much detail in for a little while longer. I can come in with a smaller brush in a minute, add a bit more detail. I'm a little bit happier now with the overall composition, but I feel that the focal point here needs a little bit more detail just to bring the eye closer in, and we want a few things to hang on to in here. So I'm going to use my rigger to come in and do some little bits, perhaps on the bridge and some of the windows. Window here. And then we've got lovely position windows actually on the mill. Itself, which will add a little bit of interest. This is just a working sketch, and I'm going to make a few changes to the borders, I think, to how far over the edge of the canvas is going to come this way, and maybe use this upright tree over here. There's a tree there. Just balance and put something in front of the mill. So I'm going to put that in. That's quite a strong greeny brown as well. So there is an upright just here. That's a strong colour. So all these decisions you can make when you're messing about in a sketch, but when you're just looking at a photograph, just tend to take it as it is. I'm going to get my pencil. Drop that line there. I'm much happier with that composition now. Around about here, I think you'd have some very general pale greens. Thank you.
And on this side as well. I think I'm going to leave it out there.
We're back in the studio now, and we're going to use the sketch we did and turn that into an oil painting. To start off with, I'm going to talk about the ground and the canvas board we're going to paint on. I've covered the canvas board in acrylic gesso, which I've mixed with a pinky colour and a warm yellow colour, and that gives a nice ground to work on, which will influence the whole painting and it'll come through. The acrylic gesso also makes a nice absorbent surface to put the oil on. I've also put an acetate sheet over the watercolour we did, and that just helps with transferring an image. I've drawn the grid, this very, very simple grid, on the canvas board using a pastel pencil. A pastel pencil is wonderful because when you apply the oil paint, it'll just disappear. It won't tint your oil paint in any way, and you can rub it out if you make a mistake. So I'm going to use this pastel pencil just to, and the grid will help me get these basic shapes in. Just balance these things out a bit. So we put our acrylic gesso down, which we've tinted. We've done some basic sketching with a pastel pencil, and now we're ready to mix some of our oil colours. I'm using artist quality oil, just three primaries, two of each primaries, plus white. And from those seven colours, you can mix pretty much the whole spectrum, which means if you go out sketching or if you're on holiday, you need to take seven tubes with you. The wonderful thing about oil paint is you can do some of your mixing right at the very beginning, get those colours organised, and they will not dry on your palette. So that's what we're going to do now. We're going to mix some tertiary mixes, that's using all three of the primaries to mix some browns for our base colours. I'm going to mix a nice yellow ochre type of colour. Add ultramarine this time. A little bit more alizarin in there just to make it nice and rich. A darker brown. And this time we're going to start off with a purple, which is made with alizarin crimson and French ultramarine. Lovely deep colour, and if you add a little bit of yellow to that mix, you'll get some rich dark browns. Of course, all of these colours you can add white to. I just want to make a nice colour for the mill itself. You need cerulean on your palette because particularly skies, you can't really make a good sky colour out of ultramarine, it's too purple. This is a nice rich brown colour I'm getting here. So we're just going to establish our dark areas first, and I'm going to use this lovely purpley brown that I've mixed here. You're keeping the paint dry because you can blend other colours into it later. If you make it too wet too quickly, the paint sort of slides around the surface of the canvas and it can become muddy and difficult to work with. So we're going to keep the paint reasonably dry for as long as possible. I'm going to go over to the other brown I mixed, which was the reddish brown. So we've established our dark areas. Remember all these lovely reds up in the mill we're going to pull down into the water. The other thing, now that we've got this lovely reddish brown, is if you put red underneath green, and we're going to have a lot of green in the foreground, it'll pull the picture forward. So I'm going to put some of these warm browns in the foreground that are going to sit under some of these greens. So this lovely reddish brown is going to go over here a little bit more. Not too wet. As I say, the idea is to keep broad brush and keep working as much as you can over as much of the painting as you can at once. Already you can see that the painting, we're actually creating depth by putting warm colours in the foreground. We're now going to move on to the sky, which the start of the sky anyway. I'm going to use a clean brush. And this is where you need your cerulean blue. Now, if you just put on cerulean blue, the sky will be pretty boring. So I'm going to mix a lot of pale, so a lot of white into that cerulean. I'm using titanium white and cerulean blue, just to make it sort of pale, pale blue there. But I'm also going to put a little bit of pink and pale yellow in the sky. I'm just going to mix up those three colours before I start. Now this cadmium red, which is an artist quality red, is extremely strong, so you need a tiny amount. It goes such a long way. I'm going to use those three in the sky. As a rule of thumb, you want the sky to be darker at the top and paler at the bottom. And if you just dab some colour on, you can use this wonderful painting technique and blend it in areas later. We can use all of those colours, and it's going to be pale at the bottom. If you have it pale at the bottom, more and dark at the top, it has this feeling of the sky going over our heads. So another wonderful thing about oil paint is that you can blend. And it also won't dry, so if you want to go back in and work on the sky some more at a later date, you can. Leave the sky for now. We put the warm tones at the bottom. Now we want to put some blues into the trees because they're distant trees, and that will push them back and create space in the middle of the picture. So I'm going to use ultramarine this time to make greens, greeny blues for, I think there were poplar trees or poplar tree types in the background here. So I have done some sketching of trees so I could get some, the more sketching and looking you do, the better. So I'm also going to use a finer brush just to do a little bit of drawing into those trees. So these distant trees, we're going to start off with them being very blue. Of course, you're going to put these trees over the sky. There's a sense of things overlapping. I'm just going to get my sketch book out with some trees I've been looking at recently to help me a little bit on this bit, get the feeling right. Take that up over there. And do this side a little bit paler. So I'm looking at my sketch now just to get the feel, that memory of how the trees feel, sort of shorthand for trees. I'm as there's a tree overlapping a tree here, and that's a little greener because it's closer to us, if you like. So I'm going to mix some greens. Obviously, wonderful thing about having two yellows and two blues is you can mix a vaster range of green colours. And I'm going to push this green right up to this rather wobbly chimney, because in a minute I'm going to show you how to make that nice and straight, that chimney. And again, you're going to be overlapping this roof down here. So I'm going to come putting more greens in the foreground. Remember, what's wonderful about this location was we can drop the greens into the water down here, and we can put them over the top of this lovely brown earth at the foreground here. You notice I'm not working from a photograph at all. I'm just looking at the original sketch we did. And there's a number of reasons for that. A, it keeps you loose. You're not getting bogged down in detail, and you're free to make changes that suit the painting, because it's the painting that's the important thing, not the photograph. So we're just working with basic shapes. And memory of the day will enter into it. I'm going to put some quite nice, brighter yellowy greens over here. And again, whatever green you mix, you can drop down into the water. I've indicated here that the greens became more yellowy around here and over here. This was this dark tree in the corner up here, which added balance to the picture. I'm just going to push that away a little bit by making it paler. In there. Nice browny bits in here. I'm just going to move on to the buildings now. We're using this lovely Cotswold stony colour that we mixed right at the beginning. I'm going to lock in this building here, side of the mill here. A bit yellower. And the same colour over here for this distant roof. And a little bit of Cotswold stone colours going on these buildings. Remember, we could see a arrangement of buildings. We weren't quite sure of detail, but there were definitely sides of buildings there. Now, I did promise you I'd show you how to get straight lines into your picture. And what I've got here is a little slither of watercolour paper. What's great about this, I use it almost like a palette knife. And you can just break it where you need it and literally cover the edge in paint. And that will give you a much straighter line than you can do with a brush. You can also drag paint across with it. It's almost like using it like a painting with a palette knife. There is definite edge, obviously I drew a definite edge to the rooftop there. And there were some Cotswold roofs are often bendy, but it's nice to have a few straight lines. So we've used the card just to indicate little bits of architecture here. A few hard edges, not too many, to define the buildings, which has worked rather well, I think. And now, something we should bring down is the lovely blue in the sky, which is also reflected into the mill pond, which is that cerulean blue. That should come down here. I'm going to bring the blue down. I did drop a few hard lines into the water as well. I look back to my sketch, there were some lovely purpley tones in the buildings over here, which I really liked. So I'm going to put those in and up here on the roof. And over here. Again, we're balancing out the picture. The important thing is the picture. The painting's at that stage now where I want to look at it and think about what I need to enhance, what bits I need to work on, because it's painted almost to the same level all the way over. So I'm just going to get back from the painting and make some decisions. I think possibly this needs to go paler in here, a little bit more detail on the bridge, and just a hint of more detail on these bushes in the foreground and over here. Well, I'm not going to use my brush for that chimney, I'm going to use a card. I did think I wanted to put some more detail on the bridge itself. I think there were railings and possibly a gate, but because I haven't drawn, I'm just going to indicate where they might have been. That's better. Now I'm going to use a nice soft brush, round brush, to look at some of the foliage in the foreground and some of the reflected greens in the water to get some soft curvy bits in as well. And mix some nice greens. And there was quite a lot of green bushes, if we remember, in the foreground. Foreground and over here, because we've got these are the trees here, and branches and things that have been reflected in the water. I wanted a little bit more detail over here because this tree, I think, okay, much better. A little bit more something. But if you're going to put something over here, then you certainly need to do a little bit more here, just to balance it out. And I have done a little bit more there in the sketch, so let's use those dark colours. Again, don't forget to mix colours into your greens all the time. Get a little bit of depth, a bit of variation. There's a dark bitness there. Great things about oil paint is that it doesn't dry. So any areas that you want to blend, you can. So this, I definitely wanted to blend some of this here. Almost like soft focus coming into a more focused area. And the same up here. There was a little bit of light, I remember talking about it, just on the water. I'm going to leave it like that.